there. I'm Sarah Thomas, and welcome to my YouTube channel, Teaching Without a Book. Have you ever struggled to find the perfect resource for your students? Whether it be it just doesn't meet the academic needs of your students, or maybe you're looking for a specific topic or theme that your students are interested in, or maybe you're just trying to save some cash and right now you just don't have the money to buy all the resources that you'd really like to be implementing into your classroom. If this sounds like you, then stick around. In today's episode, I'm going to walk you through the steps that I use to create my printable resources on Teachers Pay Teachers so that you can make your own TPT-like high-quality resources that are personalized to you and your students. Although making your own resources does take a little time, it can really be worth it. And if you are a creative type of person, I know you're gonna love making your own teaching resources. That's exactly how I got into it. I took the time to teach myself how to make my products look a little more cute and fun so that my kids would be more engaged. And I'm excited to share the tips and the tricks that I've learned so that you can get started with your own resources. So let's just jump right in and get started.
Okay, so I decided that today I'm gonna show you how I made these fun little Halloween emoji scavenger hunt task cards. I also have created a recording sheet that goes with this activity. And the reason I wanted to choose task cards is because there are just like a bunch of different things that you can do with them. You can make matching games and puzzles and flashcards. They're very versatile, and I thought this would be a great place to get started. Once you learn the basic process of creating your own resources, the possibilities are really limitless. So you'll find that it's very easy to apply this basic process to all different kinds of resources that you might be interested in making for your classroom. I want you to consider this video as sort of a creating resources 101, because I just want to show you the basic process to keep the video to a somewhat respectable time. So what I've decided to do was just link a list of ideas of different digital and paper-based resources that you can make by applying the skill that I'm going to teach you today. And then if there's anything on that list that you would like to see in more detail, then you can just let me know in the comments and I can create more videos based on your needs and what you want to see in terms of creating more resources. Today's tutorial is actually going to show you how to make resources in Google Slides. And the reason I've chosen Google Slides instead of PowerPoint or Keynote is because I feel like there's already a lot of tutorials out there on how to create resources using those programs. And I know that many districts use Google, and so I want you to be able to utilize what your district is already providing for you. So to get started in Google Slides, I'm going to go to my Waffle and I'm gonna go to Slides. And I'm gonna choose a blank one. I'm gonna get rid of the themes and get rid of the text boxes. I'm gonna create what's basically like a blank canvas for myself. Now, the first thing that I want to do is, depending on the activity that I'm going to make, I'm going to need to decide what size paper I want. It automatically creates this widescreen view, and widescreen view is not the same as a regular 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. So I generally, if I'm going to keep it in landscape, I'm going to go to File and go to Page Setup and change it from that widescreen to the standard view. Now when I create, it's the same size as a regular piece of paper, what would be in landscape view. If you wanted your activity to be in portrait, which is like the up and down way, the tall way, then you could go to File, Page Setup, and there isn't already a pre-made choice for that, so you're gonna go to Custom, and you're actually just gonna type in 8.5 by 11, just like a regular paper, and hit Apply, and now you can see that it's like a regular sheet of paper. You wanna make sure that your slide is going to reflect whatever size paper you're gonna end up wanting to print off at the end when you're done making your resource. So we're gonna go back to the landscape view, because again, I've chosen to show you how to create task cards, and when I make my task cards, I create them in landscape. When I make my resources, I am always focusing on a standard, so my resources are standard based. That's because I'm looking for things that are going to help me close gaps with my students, provide spiral review, and also help me to differentiate. So today we're going to use our task cards to create a Halloween emoji scavenger hunt for math for first grade, and I'm focusing on addition and subtraction. So that would be standards in operations and algebraic thinking. So when I title my slide, I'm going to mention the standard first. So I'm going to start with the OA and I'm going to add the .6 because that's the addition and subtraction within 20. Then I can get a little more detailed for myself and just call it Halloween emoji scavenger hunt. When I look for activities, I first look for the standard that I want, and then I can match up whether it's an evergreen activity, which is something that I can use all the time, or something that's a little bit more seasonally based. So creating your resources is super fun and super easy, and it's actually just a layering process, kind of like painting a picture, actually. You start with a background, and then you're gonna add your text, and sometimes you'll need a text frame in order for the text to stand out, and I will show you that. Then you're gonna want some clip art, and sometimes I also will add in some page borders. So let's get started with our task cards. First, I'm going to start with a background. Now, backgrounds can be color, they can be a digital background, or also called a digital paper, which is basically like a scrapbook paper, or you can use an actual real life photo in the background as well. Today, we're just gonna focus on color and the digital papers. If I wanted to add a color to the background, I would go up to my backgrounds here, and I can choose from different colors. They've already created standard colors here, but you could also make your own custom color. If you know the hex code to a color or colors that are your favorite color, you could put them in right here and hit okay, and it will bring up the color that you want. You can also choose gradient, which makes it look almost like there's a little bit of a light being shown on to the screen. It kind of casts like a shadow, and you can choose this effect with any of the colors that you want. If you want just a plain color though, you're gonna choose under solids, and then you can pick a color. So maybe I would choose orange. If you want something with a pattern or some sort of a texture in the background, then a digital paper or digital background would be a great choice for that. So to insert a digital page or background, you already have to have some downloaded, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. And what you're gonna do is you're gonna put it in your Google slide just like you would any other image or a piece of clip art. So I'm gonna go up to the insert button and choose an image, and I'm gonna upload from my computer. I have all of my resource creating things on my desktop in a folder. And so now I'm going to choose this orange background because I want it to be Halloween-y, and I'm going to just stretch it out so that it fits my slide. Unfortunately, I find that a lot of digital backgrounds come in a square shape, which makes it a little bit tricky because papers that we work on and print in our classrooms are generally the standard 8.5 by 11 pages. And so it can be a little bit tricky to find backgrounds that are gonna fit on your slides. So that's just something to watch for when you are looking for digital papers. Okay, now we have our background. The next thing I do when I make task cards is I'm going to separate the page into fours. And to do that so that I know it's nice and even, I like to just insert a table. So to insert the table, I go to insert and I choose table. And I'm going to choose a 2 by 2. And this is going to become my guide. Right now it's pretty hard to see, so I need to make sure my lines are darker and a little thicker so they're easier to see. So I'm gonna highlight the table, and I'm gonna come up to this pen where it says border color, and I'm gonna change that to black. And now I'm gonna go to the lines next to the pen, and I'm gonna change that to 2. And they're a little bit darker now. You can see it's much easier to see. And so now I'm just going to move this table and lay it right directly over my background and spread it out. And this is gonna create 4 equal boxes. So next in our layering, we already have our background and we have our table guide. The next step is to add the content or the text. To do that, we're just gonna add a text box, and I'm gonna start right here in this first card, and I'm gonna add a number sentence. And to start, I know that I'm gonna want my text to be in the middle, so I'll come to the paragraph and I'm gonna align it in the middle, and I'm gonna add my number sentence that I want. Now at this point, I want to make sure that my font is going to be easily read by my students. So that means a couple of things. It means, first of all, we need to make it bigger. It also means that I want to make sure that it's easily read on top of the background. So this background isn't nearly as bad as some backgrounds can be in terms of busyness. A lot of times it's really busy in the background and your text gets completely lost. So this is where you might need to add a text frame. And a text frame is just a small piece of background that's a solid color so that whatever text is on top of it can be read easier. You can download some cute ones that are already pre-made for you, and then you would insert them as an image, or you can make your own. So today I'm gonna show you both. So if you wanted to make your own text frame, what I do is I come up to the shapes, and when I go to my shape choices, I can select different shapes that are going to have a background that is solid, and then that will be a layer I can put behind my text to help help it pop out. So I'm just going to choose this rectangle shape. To make my shape, it turns to a plus sign. I'm gonna click and drag, and when I release, it leaves the shape behind. Now from here, I can change the shape, so I can make it bigger, so you don't need to worry about getting it exactly right, because you can manipulate it after. Right now, my shape is a gray, and it has like a light gray border. So if I wanted to change my text frame color, I would go to the paint bucket, and I'm gonna choose any color that I want in the background. And you can, again, just like with our background for the slide itself, you can choose different colors and different textures with your text frames also. I'm gonna just select white, and then to change the border, we would go to the pen for the border color, and I'm gonna select black, and I'm gonna make it a little thicker by coming over here to the border weight so that it stands out a little bit more. And so now I have a color on top of my patterned background so that my text can show up easier. Now you can see that I layered out of order, and that's okay because there are tricks to get around that so that you don't have to start all over and make a new text box with a new number sentence. In fact, a lot of times you'll get your ideas as you're working and you're building, and so you're gonna need to add things and move things around. So let me show you how to do that. Because I added my text frame after I did my text in the text box, the frame is now covering the text box because it was added last. So when I select my text frame and I come up to arrange and order, I can now change the order. And so I want to send it back because I want it to go underneath the text. So when I hit send backwards, now it's underneath my text. And that's just an easy way to fix that problem so that you're not having to redo a bunch of different layers. Another thing to think about when you're making your text for students is making sure that it's in a font that's easy for kids to read. Now, this is definitely a font that's easy for kids to read. You wouldn't want to choose something that's really crazy because you can see how, even though as an adult you can read that number 4, it is very difficult for a child to tell that that's a 4. So we don't want to add any text that is going to make it confusing for our students. Now I'm going to show you how to put in a text frame that maybe you've downloaded and you want to use. What we're going to do is go to insert, like a picture again, to our image, and we're going to upload from the computer. So again, I have mine all organized in my folder here for all my resources. Okay, so I'm going to choose this one. Now, what I want to do, because obviously it came out in a wonky size and it's a portrait, I need to fix a couple of things. So I'm going to drag the corner down to make it smaller, move it up. And this little dot on the top, when I select it, I can now turn the shape and move it around. And now I'm going to fit it into my task card frame. And now again, it's layered over my text box, which we don't want. So I can select it, and then I can come up to arrange, and I can send it backwards, and now it's right where I want it to be. So this can be a little bit bigger, and my favorite font for kiddos to read is the Century Gothic font. And I think we're probably safe to go probably to 60 with this. Yeah. So at this point, I have everything ready to go for my first task card, except for the clip art and any little embellishments that I might want to use. What I want to do next before I start working with my clip art is I want to copy and paste what I've done into the other task cards so that I don't have to do all of those steps all over again. We're going to save time by copying and pasting. I'm going to select my number sentence, and I'm going to hold the shift button, and I'm going to select my text frame. If I go up to arrange, I can choose group. Now they're one picture that I can move around and they'll stay together, which also means that I can copy and paste it in my other squares. To do that, I can go to edit and copy, and then edit and paste. Now I can just move it into the next box. So you can see this red line pops up here, and it's vertically and horizontally showing me that I have my task card lined up with the one above it and the one next to it. So I like to use those red lines to sort of help guide me so that my cards are pretty much evenly spaced. Now, obviously, I don't want the same number sentence on all of these cards. Currently, this is grouped, and so I can either go up to arrange and choose to ungroup it now, or if it's still grouped, I can just click twice on the number sentence and the box will show back up again. So now I want to change this. Okay, so now we've done our background, we've done our text, which has been created in an easily read font for our kids, and we put the text frame behind it. So now, because this is gonna be a scavenger hunt, I need to label each of these task cards with either a number or a letter so that I can create a recording sheet with correlating numbers or letters so that the students know where to write the answers for each of these different cards. And then I will be able to check their work to know what answer goes with which scavenger hunt card. So I'm just going to insert another text box right up here in the corner. And if I'm doing math, then I generally like to use letters to label. I just feel like it's just one less way to make it confusing. So I'm gonna change it back to the font that I love, and I'm gonna make it a little bit bigger, maybe like 18, and maybe make it bold so it stands out. So now I'm going to select that box, and just like we did before, I'm gonna copy and paste this all to all of the different cards so that I'm not making the same text box and formatting it over and over again. So I can do that by highlighting the text box and going to edit and copy and back to edit and paste. And now I have another one that I can drag over to my other task card. And then I try to find a spot where I can line it up so that it's gonna be pretty much the same location on all of them. The other way to do it is, of course, to click on the frame and go to Command C and then hit Command V, and that will also create another box. So I'm gonna go in and just change the letters. Now I can come in and put all the fun little cute things that I want inside of my text boxes. But before I do that, I already know that this activity, I want it to be probably about 8 different cards. And so I'm gonna get them up and moving, but 4 number sentences isn't gonna take them that long to do. And I think that they for sure could get 8 of them done. I like to give my kids choices. I will often say, choose 6 out of the 8 to do. Knowing that I'm gonna wanna create more of these task cards, I'm not gonna start putting in clip art yet, because I don't want them to look identical in terms of the clip arts. I'm gonna change up the look of each of the cards a little bit by adding the different emojis. So I'm gonna take this whole slide and I'm gonna copy the entire slide, and then I'll have an exact replica of this that I can just go in and change the text and then keep on going with my clip art. So to copy the whole slide, I'm gonna go over to the column here on the left and I'm going to select it, and it's going to get that yellow box around it. And now, just like we copy and paste anything, we can either edit and copy and edit and paste, or I can select it and I can Command C, and when I click underneath it and I see that line, I can Command V, and now I have a slide right underneath it. Be careful, because it looks like it hasn't changed on your screen, but really now you can see I'm on the second slide because that's the one that's highlighted. I've accidentally manipulated the slide I didn't want to manipulate because I forgot that it automatically put me to the screen underneath, so just be careful of that. So now it's really easy with slide number 2. All I have to do is go in and change all of my letters and create new number sentences. And now I have my second set of task cards already done, and I did not have to go through all of the layering and all of the different formatting. So we wanna work smarter, not harder. Now we get to add the clip art. So I'm gonna go back up to my first slide. I'm going to use my Halloween emojis, and that's a clip art file that I already purchased. So to insert the clip art pictures, I go up to insert again into my image, and I'm gonna upload it from my computer. I just keep my clip art and all my digital files for creating all right on my desktop, and I have them all organized so that it's easy for me to know where to go. If you're interested in learning more about how I organize my different files for creating resources, let me know in the comments and I'll do a video all about how to stay organized and save time while you're creating your resources. So I'm gonna choose holidays and Halloween, and then my pumpkin emojis. This guy's super cute. Now I'm going to just format my pumpkin so that it fits. I'm gonna go ahead and take my corner and just drag it down. I'm probably not gonna put my picture right in the middle. I'm a very asymmetrical type of person, so I can go through and I can add more emojis. You know, maybe you want to have some of your cards have 2 emojis. When I added this second pumpkin, he kind of covers up this little guy so that it looks like they're standing next to each other. This pumpkin's gonna be on top because, again, just like our other layering, we added him last. If I wanted this pumpkin to go behind that pumpkin, we would do just exactly what we did when we had to layer our text frames in our text boxes. So with this little pumpkin selected, I can go to arrange and order and send backwards. Sometimes you have to do it a couple of times. And now he's behind this guy. You could even make him a little smaller and kind of put him up a little, and that sort of makes it look like he is standing behind the pumpkin, and it gives that illusion of being a little bit further away. Now, the original scavenger hunt task cards that I showed you look like this, and they have those little speech bubbles, and that's because when I initially created this activity, I created it the same exact way that I just showed you. Then, as we're working, we get fun ideas and things come to us, and I thought it would be super cool to use a little speech bubble and make it look like the pumpkin is like saying the number sentence to the student, and it kind of just adds a little bit more creativity to it. I consider these speech bubbles an embellishment, along with other things like arrows and little sparkles or other things that you might put around your images just to add a little extra. So let me show you how I did the speech bubbles. I already had my cards and they looked just like this. I would choose my speech bubble, which are a clip art file. So you're going to insert those pictures the same way that you would like a normal piece of clip art. So I have all these different speech bubbles that I can choose from in this file that I have purchased already. Some of them you can tell are going to fit better than others. This one is going to be hard to fit a number sentence in because it's kind of more of a box shape. I want to look for more wide shape ones like this. Now I need to format it to fit it into the box. Now I have to do some other formatting of my text. I added my speech bubble and it went over my text. First, I need to push it back. So I'm gonna go to arrange, go to order, and I'm gonna say to send it backwards. I'm gonna have to do this at least twice because the pumpkin actually was the last thing that I put in. And so to get it underneath the text box, I have to do it again. And then once your text box is over the top of the speech bubble, we need to change this to white so that it will pop out. And so I can do that by going to the A and then the white, and now it's white. If I want to make the speech bubble and the text box one picture so that it's easier to move around, see how when I move them separately, now I have to like line them all back up again, and that's pretty annoying. So what I can do is, just like I did with the text frame in the text initially, select the text box, hold shift down to select the speech bubble, come up to arrange, and then I can group them so that they are one thing that I can move around. And I can even like shift them by going up to the little dot on the top. Now it looks like the pumpkin really should be over here though, right? Because his little mouth is here and the little speech bubble is kind of coming from this location. If I wanted to keep him over here, I have to ungroup this first because I don't want to flip everything around, but I can select just my speech bubble. And if I go to arrange, to rotate, I can actually flip it horizontally and change the direction of that speech bubble. And then I can just kind of format the text box so that it fits in here again. So you can flip your clip arts around just by going to arrange. The other thing I did was I changed this font so that it looked a little bit more Halloween-ish. This one I feel like is still pretty easy to read. So it's called Creepster. And then I would just go through and I would format all the rest of these cards in the same way that I did that. Next, I'm going to show you how to make the recording sheet that goes with this activity. This will be the sheet that the kids will carry around on a clipboard and solve the problem. Okay, so this is what it's going to look like at the end. You can see that there are boxes for the kids to show their work, and each box has a letter that they can match to the scavenger hunt card that they are taking the number sentence off, and that way you can check their work. To create the recording sheet, I'm going to click under the last slide of task cards, and I'm going to go up here to the little plus sign where there is a drop down arrow, and I'm going to click the arrow and choose blank. I'm not going to put a background on this. I want the background to be white so our students can write on it. I'm going to start by adding my text. And my favorite text, again, for kids is the Century Gothic. So I'm going to put name and then the directions. Sign the emoji card with the matching letter to each box. Draw a picture to solve each number sentence in the box with the matching letter. And then maybe make directions bold. So now we have to add our boxes. There are 8 cards. I'm gonna use a table because it's the easiest way to make boxes that are even. So I go to insert and I choose table. I'm gonna choose a 4x2 because we have 8 cards. And just like with our text box, I'm gonna highlight it and I'm going to change the border color so that it's black. And I'm gonna change the thickness to 2 so it's a little bit easier to see. And then at this point, I'm going to pull it and make it as big as I would like like it to be so that my kids can work. I'm gonna add a little space because I think I'm gonna put a border around this, so I might just move this text box down a little bit. And the last thing that we need to do is add the letters so that they can have the matching letter to the card. Now, what's nice about a table is you don't have to add text boxes because you can already type in them. But I am going to select it and I'm gonna change it to the font that I want all of them to be so that I'm not changing the font in every box. And I'm going to increase the size for all of them as well. And I can put A and just tab over to each box and insert the letter. Now I can add in a page border if I want to. I tend to use page borders more on worksheets or recording sheets. They are very similar to a text frame. They're just bigger. So basically where a text frame outlines the text, the page border outlines the page. You can make your own or you can just download a design to use. You make your own the same exact way that you would make your own when you use the text frame. So we would go to our shapes, we would drag, and then what we're gonna do is instead of having a color, because we want it to stay white, we're gonna go to the paint box and we're gonna change it to transparent. Now we have this little skinny and scrawny outline. Click back on it and then you can change the border width and then change the color to black. So that's one way that you can do a text frame. Just remember that now though, this text frame is on the top. So if I wanted to edit anything, I'm clicking on it right now and I can't access any of those. And that's because my page border is on top. So I just like to select that page border, go to arrange, and I'm just gonna put it all the way to the back. And now I know it's completely out of my way. I can select all of these things to edit if I need to. You can also buy or download free different page borders as well. And so if you have done that, you can upload from your computer just like any other piece of clip art and you can hit open and it's gonna bring it right to your page. Okay, now this one is not transparent in the middle and that's okay because we can send it to the back and it will go right behind everything. But before we do that, you can see it's in portrait, so I need to drag it around to the side so that it will be the landscape view and then I'm gonna fit it to my page. I'm just gonna go up to arrange and I'm gonna send it all the way to the back and now it's in the back. You can also even add in some matching clip art that you may have used. So you're gonna go just to inserting your clip art the same way you did before. Only this time you're gonna choose the black and white and you can kind of rearrange him wherever you want him to go. And you can make your task cards in black and white as well. Almost all clip artists sell their products with both clip arts that are in color as well as black and white versions so that you can save ink by printing just on colorful paper if that works better for you as well. You wouldn't wanna use a background for those because they're gonna look really yucky when you print them, like a dark yucky gray. So you would not wanna use a background with those. And then lastly, before I print, I like to come back and I like to remove that. And that's because when I cut my task cards, I find it really hard to not get little bits of the black on the edges. And yes, that actually really does bother me. So I take it out and I just cut my cards without the black lines there. I usually go through and just click on the table and get rid of that before I print. Now with Google Slides, one of the delightful things is you can just print it right from Google Slides. But if you wanted to share this with somebody that you work with, you would just share it just like anything else in Google Docs. I do just want to show you how to turn it into a PDF. So what you're going to do is you're going to go to File and you're going to go to Download. And you can see right here, you can choose PDF. And when it's done, you can open it up and then you have just a regular old PDF of the resource that you just created. So before we end our video today, I want to just give you a couple of pointers for where you can find backgrounds and clip arts and different digital files that you need in order to create your resources. I get everything except for my fonts through Teachers Pay Teachers. There are many amazing clip artists and graphic designers that sell their work to teachers and they know exactly what teachers are looking for. So you can search for clip art and digital backgrounds and borders and text frames and all of those things the same way that you would search for any other teaching resource. So you go to the search bar and you can search for digital paper and it's going to bring up a bunch of digital paper papers. If you look at this one, it comes with the papers and borders, text frames, and different embellishments. That is a great place to get started, is with one of these toolkit bundles, because then it gives you all of those things that we talked about today. If you don't have the money to spend up front, that's totally fine. When you're searching digital papers, come down here and just click on the free button, and it's gonna bring up a bunch of different free things. Of course, this means you're gonna have to kind of henpick through and find what works for you, but there are so many wonderful free resources that you can download just to get you started. And that includes, again, all the things we talked about today, the papers and the borders and all of that. So I would just suggest going through and searching. And then when you find one that you like, you can just click on it, you can download it, and then you can save that file to wherever you want it to go. Personally, my favorite clip artist is Krista Walden, and I pretty much get everything through her, because you can see over here on the side, like, she's got a gajillion things to choose from. Now, if you're not working in Google, you can also purchase fonts from Teachers Pay Teachers. But as of right now, with this video that I'm creating, you can't use other fonts in Google Slides except for Google Fonts. So I wanna make sure that I show you how to find different fonts in Google. You can come up to where the fonts are here. These are all the ones that I currently have downloaded from Google. Now, the way that you find new fonts in Google is by going to the font dropdown, and all the way at the top, it says more fonts. When you click that, it takes you to a bunch of different fonts. The ones that you already own are blue with a check mark. And of course, depending on when you're watching this video, it may not look exactly like this, but if I wanted to choose a new font, I can click on that and then I can hit okay. And it just changed whatever I already had highlighted to that new font, but then it's also available up here for me to use. So you can come to Google and you can look through all of their fonts by going to more fonts. It's an easy way to grab some free fonts. You have to use the fonts in Google if you're using Google Slides. So the fonts are a little more limiting. But again, I wanted to show you how to do this through Google Slides, because I know that so many of you are already using it and it's already provided to you by your district. And there's no reason why you should have to purchase a new program just in order to be able to make your own resources.
I hope you found this video to be helpful and that you learned some really great things that you can use right away in your classroom. If you have any questions or if you'd like to dig a little deeper into this topic, just let me know in the comments. I also included links to videos of related topics in the description so that you can get started on watching some of those as well. I would love it if you could take the time to help me reach even more teachers by sharing this video. And don't forget to turn on your notification bell so that you don't miss any future episodes. Thank you so much for joining me today and for watching this video all the way to the end. Now go use those creative brains and make education amazing. See you next time.